In this video, I will talk about the conjugate gradient method, which is a very famous method for computing the solution of a system of linear equations. Hi, my name is Frank and welcome on my channel. We will deal with the following system of linear equations, which contains n variables and n equations, and they are coupled in the following form. And the question is, how does a possible algorithm may look like to find a solution to this system? And in the following, I will introduce you to the method of conjugate gradients, or in short, the CG method, which is a very famous method for solving such a system if the coefficients A satisfy a specific form. But we'll come to this later. Before we start with the mathematics, we'll do some historical information. The method was first introduced in 1952 by Hastenes and Stiefel, so it's 70 years old. It's quite an old method, but it's a very super and a very efficient and very famous method. You should already know some stuff to understand this video. In particular, you should have a basic understanding of linear algebra. In fact, you should know about eigenvalues, eigenvectors, the eigenvalue decomposition, how to handle matrices, matrix vector multiplication, and stuff like this. And it's good to have some basic understanding of optimization, although it's not necessary to understand this video. I will introduce you to everything you will need. Before we start, we will rewrite the problem to a linear system, A times X equals B, with some matrix A, some right-hand value vector B, and some unknown vector X, which we are looking for. This is a standard transformation, it's just matrix vector multiplication. Of course, A is a real n times n matrix, and x and b are vectors in the space Rn. If you've watched a video of me, you probably know that I'm a huge fan of optimization, and rewriting problems into optimization form is usually a huge boost to understanding what's actually going on here, to understand the problem, and probably to find a solution. So in our case here, we are looking at the following function. We want to minimize the following function, x transposed ax minus b transposed x. And in the following, we assume that A is a symmetric matrix. If we do so, we know that the solution of x star of this optimization problem satisfy ax star equals b, and this is exactly what we want to solve. Okay, if we assume that A is positive definite, we know that exactly one solution exists, but this is not so important. Main result of the theorem here is that we can couple our problem with the solution of an optimization problem. The proof is quite easy. Just assume that X star is a solution to our minimization problem. Then, of course, it must satisfy the first order optimality conditions. Reading, the gradient of F must be zero. Plug in x star and you end up with a x star minus b, bring b to the other side, and you get the result of our theorem. From now on, we assume that A is a symmetric and positive matrix. This means that the following function, which contains of two arguments, x and y, which is just x transpose ay, is a scalar product. This means it's a bilinear positive, positive definite form. Using this notation, we can rewrite our function f so it looks like this. And we're gonna ask ourselves the following question. What defines the set of vectors from the optimal point x star such that they all have the same function value of f? To do so, we define the vector x0, which is just x star plus some offset e0, and compute f applied to x0. Just plug in the definition, you can see it here. Make use that we have here a scalar product, so it's a bilinear form. Split it into the following sets. And we end up with this huge long term here. Now we make use that x star is an optimal point of our optimization problem. So this means it satisfies ax star equals b. This means that we can rewrite this following term, which is just e0 transpose ax, but ax is just b. So this term here is just e0 transpose b, and this cancels out with this term here. So basically, we will end up with the following term. These are the terms that are left. And if we combine these two terms into our function f, which just by definition is just fx star, we end up with fx0 is just f of x star, which was our optimal point, plus the offset e0 transpose a e0. This means that the offset of our function f, or in other terms, the difference of x0 and fx star is completely determined by the following error term, which is just e0 transpose a e0. And this will come in handy later, because we now can take a look at the structure of e0 transpose a0. Let's visualize this a little bit. Here we have in a two-dimensional examples, and our optimal point is now x1 star and x2 star, which is a component, which is a vector in R2. And we want to take a look at the contour lines, or the lines where our equation, our function f, is constant. And this function, or this equation fx is constant z, this is describes an ellipse. So you can see the plot here. In the middle, you have our optimal point x star, and the blue lines, which are circled around x star. If you travel on this line, the function value of f stays constant. So if I travel here, it's a constant. If I travel here, it's constant. But the important thing is these blue lines are ellipses. And now we hop into deep linear algebra, the so-called eigenvalue decomposition. We assume that A is symmetric and positive definite. Then we know that there exist n positive eigenvalues, I call them lambda I, and normalized eigenvectors, which I call qi, in the following form, that we can express our matrix A as the matrix product of q, lambda, and q transpose. And of course, you know that q consists of the eigenvalues. Lambda is a diagonal matrix which contains only the eigenvalues lambda I. And of course, we know that qi are linear independent, and that the inverse of q is q transpose, and stuff like that. So this is the classical eigenvalue decomposition, and we make heavy use of this decomposition here. So what we're going to do now is we define another space, which is the so-called eigenspace. First, we know that qi, which are the eigenvectors, they are linear independent. But this means that qi divided by the square root of lambda I is also an independent set, linear independent set, of course. This allows us to express our offset as a linear combination of our new vectors. And the resulting space I call the so-called eigenspace. And let's do a little bit of calculation. We compute the following expression. First, we gather all the coefficients ci, which comes from the linear combination of our expression of e0. I gather them in a vector c, and I calculate q times square root of lambda times c. If you do the calculations here, let's just plot them here, you can see that this term is exactly e0. So this means that we have for our representation vector c, we can express them as we have the following relation between our original vector in the Cartesian space and our vector c in the eigenspace. We have the following relation: e0 is q times square root of lambda times c. We will now make use of this. Again, we have c is representation vector of e0 in the eigenspace. And now we want to compute the following expression, e0 transpose a e0. Because this was the difference between fx0 and fx star. So this is the term we want to calculate. So take the relation e0 and this term here, plug it into this equation, replace a by q lambda q transpose, and now solve the transpose. So bring it to the other side, and what you will end up is the following term. You see, Q transpose Q is the identity, so this term drops out, this term drops out, and we end up with the following term. And again, lambda, square root of lambda times square root of lambda is, of course, is the identity. So we end up that E0 transposed AE0 is just Z transposed Z. It's the norm of the representation vector in the eigenspace computed with the Rn norm. So in other terms, two points have the same function value if the representation vectors have the same distance from the origin. In other words, they describe a circle in the eigenspace. So remember, go back two or three slides. The contour lines where f had the same function value describes an ellipse in the standard Cartesian space, but they describe a circle inside the eigenspace. So let's have a quick visualization here. Again, you have the ellipses here, which contains points with the same function value of f. I draw here the eigenvectors of A, which are of course the main axis of the ellipse here. And if we transpose these ellipses into our eigenspace, well, we end up with circles. So in the eigenspace, these ellipses, they become circles. And this is, of course, super nice. So this is, keep this in mind, this is what's going on with the transformation which we've done so far, the transformation in the eigenspace. And we will make now, of course, we make heavy use of this, but first we have to put this into some solid definitions. We say that a set of vectors is called A-orthogonal if the following condition holds. We compute di transposed adj, and this must be zero for all I not equal to j. If a is zero, of course, all vectors are A-orthogonal, but this is kind of useless. And if a is chosen to be the identity, this then reduces to the classical definition of orthogonality. And this definition is, of course, the right definition to capture orthogonality inside the eigenspace. And this is part of the next theorem. Two vectors are A-orthogonal if the representatives inside the eigenspace are orthogonal. We assume again that A is symmetric and positive definite. Let's take a look at the proof. The proof is quite simple. We take two vectors, v1 and v2, they should be A-orthogonal, and the representatives inside the eigenspace are called c1 and c2. And now we compute v1 transposed AV2. This is the same calculation as we've done before. We place v1 with q lambda c1, or with q inverse square root of c1, and similar for v2. Calculate those products, those terms drops out, this is the identity, and we end up this v1 transposed AV2 is exactly c1 transposed c2. So this is the correct definition to capture orthogonality inside the eigenspace. We know even a little bit more. We know that if we have a set of A-orthogonal vectors, then we know that they are linearly independent. The proof is quite simple, it's done by contradiction. Let's assume that the set d0 to dk is not linearly independent. So we can assume that, of course, without lots of generality, we can express dk as a linear combination of d0 and up to dk minus 1. But of course, this leads directly to a contradiction, because by definition, we know that dk transposed adk is greater than zero. This is the definition of the A-orthogonality. Let's replace the last dk by the linear combination of d0 to dk minus 1. You can see it here. Put dk transposed A inside the sum, and you end up with terms containing dk transposed A di. But I is always less than k. So this term, again by definition of A-orthogonality, is zero. So this leads to the contradiction, 0 is less or strict less than 0. So this proves the theorem. Why is A-orthogonality useful here? Let's assume that x star satisfies Ax star equals b, and let's assume we have a set d0 to dn minus 1 which is A-orthogonal. By the last theorem, we know that these n vectors are linearly independent, meaning they form a spanning system, they form a basis, and this means we have a set of alpha I in such a way that x star can be expressed as a linear combination of the di. And this is interesting, because now we can compute dk transpose ax star. Let's replace x star by linear combination of the di. This you can see it here. Again, move dk transpose inside the sum, and you will end up with terms containing dk transpose a di. And this is perfect, because by a orthogonality we know this is 0 except if a is equal to k. So this means dk transpose a x star is alpha k dk transpose a dk. We know a little bit more. We know this term dk transpose a dk is greater than 0. So let's divide this expression by dk transpose a dk. And we end up with alpha k being dk transpose a x star divided by this term here. We have not used yet that ax star is b, so let's replace ax star with b. And we know that alpha k is the expression you can see here on the right hand side. Why is this good? Why is this useful? You can see again here x star as a combination of the di. Here you can see our calculated expression for alpha k. So let's put everything together. We know x star is linear combination, and we know alpha I. So let's replace alpha I by our result we just obtained. And you end up that x star is the sum of this term here. It might look a little bit complicated, but I want to point out something. It is very interesting that we do not see x star on the right hand side. We only see a and b, but a and b are known. We know this a priori. What we didn't know a priori is x star, because we want to compute x star. So this is interesting, because this gives us the possibility to form or to formulate a very basic method. Again, these are the same terms I just presented to you, because if we are able to generate a orthogonal set, we can simply compute these alpha k's and compute x star, because we know then alpha i can be computed knowing only the matrix A and B, and well, just compute a linear combination and you are done. And this is the very basic algorithm of the conjugate gradient method. Let's take a look at a bit in detail. We start with x0 being 0, and we can calculate xk plus 1 is xk plus alpha k dk. If k plus 1 is n, we end up with this linear combination of the di's, which is of course by construction xx star. So all we have to do now is to find a method how we could generate those a-orthogonal vectors at runtime. Now it comes in hand that we have a scalar product defined at the very beginning of the video. Because if you remember, x transpose ay, which was our scalar product defined by subscript a, we can use the standard Gram-Schmidt algorithm to generate an a-orthogonal system. Because by definition, the Gram-Schmidt algorithm generates a sequence which is orthogonal with respect to this chosen scalar product. But this scalar product is exactly a definition of a-orthogonality. So the Gram-Schmidt algorithm is the method of choice here to generate an A-orthogonal system. I'm not going into detail of the Gram-Schmidt process. You can just go to the Wikipedia page. It's very good described there. It's very described in detail. You can take a look at this page. I'm just presenting here the algorithm. We start with a linear independent basis, a linear independent set of vectors, which are called V0. And these vectors will be used to generate a set of vectors D, which are an A-orthogonal series, A-orthogonal set of vectors. And it is just done simply by subtracting the non-orthogonal part. This is a very basic idea of the Gram-Schmidt process. Again, I'm not going into details here. But at the end, we will end up with an A-orthogonal set. And this is perfect because this is all we are left in our conjugate gradient method, our very basis just one slide before. So let's take the definition of the outcome of the Gram-Schmidt process and put it into our conjugate gradient method. Just one detail, the Gram-Schmidt process needs some sort of independent vectors to generate an output. And we will choose this to be the residuum. So again, we assume A to be a symmetric and positive definite matrix. We start with x0 being 0. And now we define the residuum, which is just B minus AXK, and we call this RK. And we use Gram-Schmidt to generate an A-orthogonal system using the residuum. You can see this here. This is the outcome of the Gram-Schmidt algorithm if we apply the algorithm to the residuum. Alpha k again are the calculated coefficients of our linear combination of x star, and this is just iterative process to generate x star. At the end, by construction, this will give axn to be b, and this is nice. This is the conjugate gradient method in all its beauty. Of course, this are just three lines here, but in these three lines, we have to put a lot of theory inside it. I mean, we started with moving some vectors and some ellipses to the eigenspace. You have to define what is orthogonality inside the eigenspace. How does this transform back to the Euclidean space, to the standard space? And there's a lot of theory going behind it. But in the end, you have a method which will generate the exact solution after n steps. And this is interesting because the normal standard algorithms, they only give an approximation, but this algorithm will give the exact solution after n steps. Of course, we do not consider numerical errors here. But this is the very idea of the conjugate gradient method. So just generate an A-orthogonal set of vectors and use our theory to generate a linear combination of this A-orthogonal vectors, which in the end will give us the exact solution of our system. So there's one last question we have to answer. Why is this method called conjugate gradient method? Well, it's called conjugate because the vectors dj, which are used to update the iterates xxj, they are A-orthogonal. So it's just another word for it. And it is called a gradient method since we are, in the beginning, I told you, think about optimization problem. And the ax minus b is the gradient of this function here. So that's why it's called a gradient method. And the combination of both, this gives the name conjugate gradient method. I want to give you also, if you're interested, some additional information. The conjugate gradient method actually belongs to a wider class of the so-called Grillov subspace iteration methods. Just Google Grillov subspace iteration or Grillov method and you'll find a lot of literature where you can start getting more information if you're interested in this actually quite interesting class of solvers. So we are at the end of this video. Let's do a small recapitulation. Well, we know that the definition of A-orthogonality captures orthogonality inside the eigenspace. We know that, or we see that Gram-Schmidt allows us to generate an A-orthogonal basis, which in the end gives us a sequence of points converging to the correct solution. In fact, we know that after n steps, the conjugate gradient method gives the exact solution. So this is the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it. You learned a little bit about the conjugate gradient method. If you have any questions, just write it in the comments and I'm happy to answer it. See you around, have fun, and cheers!